Hello students, today we are going to conduct a revision lecture on timber ground floor construction. So you know already what is meant by timber ground floor construction. Now a timber ground floor construction is also called as a suspended timber floor. The reason for that is that the floor is not at the ground level, but it is raised above the ground level, and the portion below the floor is left hollow to form a space below it. This hollow portion is purposefully kept because these timber floors are normally used in cold climates, and the space below the floor acts as a thermal insulation for the floors. So this is an example or a typical floor, this is a typical floor plan of a room, which is a room of size 4 meter by 6 meter, and across the shorter span you have got these members of the floor which are called as the floor joists. These joists are placed at a distance of 4 meter length. So if you have a 4 meter long joist, you can place an entire joist from end to end, or if there are smaller joists, then a 2 meter joist and another 2 meter joist can be placed side by side. Now what you see here is the load bearing wall, which you can see here, which is a 230 thick brick wall in this case. And in the center, what you will see is a wall which we call as a sleeper wall. The sleeper wall has got hollow portions in between which allow the passage of air into this cavity below the floor. So this type of wall is also called as a honeycombed sleeper wall. We'll see more about it later. So now let us try to see the construction of this floor. As I told you, there are load bearing walls here on the sides, and in the center there is a half brick thick wall. The floor joists are resting on these three walls, and on top of these floorboards you will have the floorboards. So let me show the floorboards here. So these floorboards will now come at right angles to the floor joists. You will also see that maybe you will not be having the floorboards of such an entire length of 6 meter, and therefore we might use smaller floorboards, and in that case these floorboards will have a joint in between. As you can see, this is a joint between the floorboards along the length of the floorboard. So one important point to note is that this joint is not in one line, but alternate floorboards are having a joint which is staggered on one joist here and the alternate joist on the other side. This is done so that you have a proper look for the floor. If this joint was given in one line, there is always a possibility that the joints will not properly align, and this will look like a jagged type of a joint, and therefore these are always staggered. Now let us talk about how the loads get transferred. So along with these floor joists and floor boards, what you will see here is that there is a wall plate which is placed on this wall, another wall plate which is placed on the other wall here, and on the sleeper wall also there is a wall plate which is placed here. Now the load from the floor boards is transferred to the floor joists, and from the floor joists it goes as a point load on this wall. So the wall plate has got various functions. So first function is that when the load from the joists comes in the form of a point load, the wall plate actually distributes the load over the entire length of the wall in the form of a UDL. So that is the first function of the floor, the wall plate. Now let us look at this in a perspective view, so you will understand how the wall plate is. So as you can see, this is a wooden member. The wall plate is a wooden member, and as you can see here, it has got these notches which are corresponding to the floor joists. Now, one of the important thing that this type of a joint does is that it holds these joists in position and does not allow them to move sideways. So that is the first function of this type of a joint. This type of joint is called as a housed joint. The second function of this is that we can increase or decrease the depth of this notch, thereby aligning the level of the floor joists in a perfectly horizontal line. So if the floor joists are not of the same size, then what we'll see is that we can use this depth of the notch to adjust the top level of these joists so that they come in the same horizontal line. So that is the second function of the wall plate, or rather the third function of the wall plate. First function was to distribute the load over the wall. Second was to hold the joist in position so that it does not move laterally. The third reason is that it levels the joist so that the top of the joist come in the same level. And the fourth function is that when this joist is subjected to load, it has a tendency to topple over sideways, and this house joint actually holds the floor joist in position and does not allow the joist to topple over. So these are the four functions of the wall plate. Now similarly, you can see the similar type of the wall plate on top of the sleeper wall. This is the sleeper wall which I told you about. This is a half brick thick wall. So as you can see, since it's a half brick thick wall, the joint in this is all stretchers are there. So this is a stretcher bond which is there, and this is a half brick thick wall. Now if you observe this half brick thick wall, what you will see is that some of the bricks in between have been removed to form such type of pattern or hollows in between. The reason for making these hollows is that it allows the passage of the air through these walls, so that this entire space, this hollow space below the floor, is ventilated. You will see this also in the form of these special type of bricks which are provided here. These are four bricks which are provided in the four corners, as you can see here. So this is one brick, second brick, third brick, and the fourth brick. So these are specially molded bricks which are having these types of holes in between. These are cast, and they are again allowing the passage of the air through them, and therefore what you will see is that there is a proper ventilation established between for the space which is there below the floor, the hollow portion in below the floor. So these special type of bricks, they are called as the air bricks. What you can see here is these are four bricks which are placed at the four corners. You will also see another detail here is that the wall plate is fixed to the sleeper wall by means of these metal straps. So the tendency of this wall plate would be to move as a result of the load, and therefore to keep this wall plate in position and not allow it to move, this is fixed with the help of these steel straps. So as you can see, there is one steel strap here, another steel strap here, the third steel strap there, and so on. So there will be three or four steel straps which will connect the wall plate to the sleeper wall. So as I told you, the function of the basically the air bricks and the sleeper wall with the hollow portion. Now this hollow portion sleeper wall is also called as the honeycombed sleeper wall. This is also called as honeycombing or honeycombed sleeper wall, that is hollows inside the sleeper wall. So what you will see is that there is a sort of ventilation established. The air will come in through this air brick. it will go below this cavity, it will pass through the hollow portions in the sleeper wall and come out through the air brick at the other end. Now, why is it necessary to have this ventilation below this floor? So remember, one thing is that the timber is subjected to a type of fungus called as a dry rot fungus. Now, this dry rot fungus thrives in conditions where there is no air or there is less movement of air. Such conditions are called as anaerobic conditions. So therefore, it is very essential that the space must be kept ventilated, that the air must be kept moving in. And that is why we have this elaborate arrangement of air bricks and the honeycombed sleeper wall in the center. So that is the function of the air bricks and the honeycombed sleeper wall. Now, talking about the floor boards, as you can see, the floor boards are roughly around 100 to 125 in width, and the thickness is about 25 mm. And all these floor boards are joined to each other by means of what is called as a tongue and groove joint. We have already learnt about this tongue and groove joint earlier. So this is a lengthwise joint which goes right from end to end. So if I try to separate out one of these boards, what you will see is that there is a continuous tongue here, and on the other side what you will see is that there is a groove which is made inside this floorboard, which is a continuous groove which goes along the length. So this is how this groove fits into the tongue here. So this is called as a tongue and groove joint. So I think this will explain to you mostly what is meant by the timber ground floor. Now, one last point which is remaining is this gray portion which you are seeing below. So this entire floor is actually covered with a 100 mm thick concrete or PCC. The reason for this is that this PCC prevents the moisture in the ground from rising into this hollow space, and it also protects from the burrowing animals from coming inside. Like for example, rats and other things could burrow through the ground and come inside this space. So the concrete does not allow those animals or burrowing animals to come inside. It also acts as a sort of a foundation for this sleeper wall. So if we look at this in an X-ray view, what we will see is that this is the 100 thick PCC which is there, or concrete layer which is there below, in just above the ground level. And as you can see, the sleeper wall is actually directly resting on this PCC layer. The external walls obviously are not going to be supported by this PCC, but they will have their own stepped foundation, as we have learnt earlier what is meant by step foundation for the load bearing wall. So similarly, they will have a foundation below them. So that will be a step foundation with a PCC below that. So I hope this clears or gives you a fair idea about the timber ground floor. Thank you.